All right. Thanks. So I hope we're going to close now the spanning tree things and the bridges and all these things. If it was a little bit confusing, it is, until you sit down and do a few examples, and then it's not so bad, actually. It's quite not so difficult to understand. So I encourage you to do that. So now we're going to switch over to wireless, to Wi-Fi. So why wireless? Well, I mean, wireless is outstanding when it comes to providing service when we're on the move. So when there is mobility, then we need to be wireless because we don't want to be attached with a wire to the network. So wireless communication is really compelling, and it's actually needed when we have mobility. Roaming, for instance, means that we can move between different networks, so we want to be able to access information anywhere. It's also actually compelling when there is difficulty to actually put down a wired network due to cost or regulations or so forth. It's expensive or even perhaps even impossible to dig down new cables in different places, for instance, where the infrastructure really doesn't help us here. There could be like a city, an old city, where it's actually very expensive to draw new cables. And then wireless is nice. So the challenges with wireless is that, first of all, it's a shared medium. Radio channels are shared. So we cannot confine easily the power of the transmitted signal. So it will interfere with everything. So a transmission in this room will interfere with the rest of the universe, in principle. Maybe not so so much at the distance, but surely around the transmission. So signal strength can vary both in space and also in time, depending on the propagation environment. So if the weather is nice, it might be better propagation environment than if the weather is bad. Summer and winter can also change depending on the number of leaves on the trees and things like that. So it's harder to predict. From a security point of view, signals which are transmitted on wireless are susceptible for interception. So it's very easy to listen to the medium and pick down signals. So they could be captured by eavesdroppers. So we have to be more concerned about security when it comes to wireless than on wired networks, because it's easier to listen to a wireless network than to a wired one. We'll talk more about that next week. Spectrum is also very limited and heavily regulated. So mobile, meaning that we have to share this spectrum somehow, and it's actually we have to have permission to transmit radio signals, and the permissions are handed out by the state, by the government. So in Sweden, it's Post och telestyrelsen, PTS, who does this. Right. So I cannot just form a network with my own equipment and start to transmit. It's illegal. Right. Meaning that, I mean, of course, I can buy an access point at Clas Ohlson and start to use Wi-Fi. That's okay, but I cannot do my own radio transmitters with my own modulation and so forth. I have to abide to the laws, the rules. So mobile access to the internet is dominated by two things, really. It's Wi-Fi that we will talk about today, and cellular that we won't talk much about at all in this course. Okay, so Wi-Fi or 802.11. When starting wireless, one has to, first of all, we need spectrum. Otherwise, we will not be able to transmit any signals, and therefore there will be no wireless systems. So this spectrum was made available in 1985, a shared spectrum in these bands. And then there was some work started around 91, and the first release was in 1997. And it's called 802.11-1997. And since then, it's evolved in a very, very complex and standard. And there are new versions of this standard constantly being pushed out, right? So now the description in the book is therefore a little bit dated. It's old. I mean, it was a snapshot of the standards at that time, so it's much more complex now. So the 2012 version of this has 2,793 pages. Okay, so it's a thick document, right, describing all options. Now, far from all of these pages are actually used in practical systems, but they are there because they've been standardized at some point. And these are constantly being evolving, so there is no stop in this, right? It will continue to evolve. So I took a snapshot of my Wi-Fi settings this morning, on a Mac you can do this, and then I have some information about Wi-Fi here. SSID, security, BSSID, channels, country code, RSSI, noise, transmit rate, physical mode, and modulation coding index. So what does this mean, right? So that's we're going to go through, not perhaps everything in very much detail, but we will go through all of these things. But a highlight of this is that this is basically the network name. So I was attached to EduRoam. Here's where I log in. I give my credentials and so forth and get access to this network. There is some security. There should be security on all networks now. Really, one should be careful of using networks with no security, or one should not use them, essentially, if one can avoid it. And this one uses this particular type of security. We'll talk more about that next week. BSSID here is the MAC address. This is an Ethernet address, a MAC address, and it's the MAC address of the access point I was attached to at that point. So if I would look now, I would probably still be attached to EduRoam, but to some other access point, because I moved from my office here to some other part of the building, and there will be another access point serving me at this time. When I was in my office, I used channel number 1, which is a 2.4 gigahertz, and it was a 20 megahertz wide channel. 20 megahertz is more or less standard, but channels could switch depending on configuration. I was in Sweden. I knew this. This was the received signal power from the access point. It was minus 75 dBm. dB, you know, dBm means that 0 dBm is 1 milliwatt. So I received 75 dB below 1 milliwatt. So quite a low received power. But luckily, the noise level is even lower. It's at minus 90. So the difference between these two is the signal-to-noise ratio, which in this case is, 15 dB. Okay. The higher the signal-to-noise ratio is, the higher data rate I can use. So in this case, it was 59 megabits per second. Using a type of physical mode, which is known as this, with the modulation coding index like that. We will see a little bit more what that means later on. Okay, so there are many, many definitions in these 2,700 pages. So a few of them, which are the most essential one, is that there is something called a basic service set. The basic service set is essentially a number of wireless stations that have negotiated that they should communicate. So these are the friends. So if we have, for instance, a number of stations here, station A, B, and C. These are all Wi-Fi nodes, and they want to communicate. Then they can form a basic service set, and let's call that basic service set number 1. Okay. Typically, there are two types of service sets, one infrastructure and one which is not infrastructure. So the ones that we will concentrate on now on infrastructure. So that means that in this basic service set, there is a special node called the access point. And the access point is where all communication goes through. So all of these stations communicate via the access point. So if B wants to talk to C, it goes through the access point. Okay, and the basic service set has an ID, which is the basic service set ID, which is not very strange, perhaps. And that is equal to the MAC address for the access point. So this access point has a MAC address, and that is the BSS ID for this BSS. Okay. the access point is probably hooked up with a wired network somehow, or some type of network, to a node here, which is known as the portal, which is a router. And from here, we can go to the internet. This is typically the case, right? So there is could be some wired network here, but it could be also wireless. Local area network that connects the access point to the portal, and the portal is then the gateway out to the internet. Okay, now there might be also other access points. Here, and that is then responsible for the communication within another basic service set, which might overlap with the first one. So there might be a station D, which is in the middle here. But D here happens to be associated with access point number two. So it would communicate with this one, even though it might be that access point number one is actually closer. It depends a little bit. Right? And then we have E and, say, F here. They all communicating with this access point. Okay, and this is then the basic service set number two. And this access point might be attached to the same network or some other network. We don't know, but it could be to a portal of this nature. Okay, so we have two access points, a number of stations. We have two basic service sets. Now, if they happen to be in the same network, maybe this is EDIROM and this is also EDIROM. Doesn't necessarily have to be that. It could be different networks, right? If you pop up your device, you would see a bunch of networks available there, right? And so there are different networks. But if they are from the same network, then together these forms an extended service set. And the extended service set is essentially the network. So for instance, EDIROM. Okay. So we have access points. All of them are responsible for communication in one physical area. And this physical area is called the basic service area. Or BSA. So another way to think about it is the basic service area could be the like a cell in a cellular system. It's a geographical area which is served by a base station, or in this case by an access point. Several of these access points together forms a network that provides coverage for the users. So if a node station C is moving into this area, it can switch its association from this access point to this access point. Okay. Without the user here actually knowing this. Okay. So I don't have to do anything as a user. I just take my laptop and I move from my office here, and I'm still connected to EDIROM, but I'm pretty sure I have another access point here than what I had over there. Questions? Okay. So, recap. Basic service set is essentially a cell where we have an access point, and the BSI ID is the MAC address of the access point. It's located in the basic service area, which is a geographical area which it serves, essentially. Stations in the BSS can communicate with each other, and distinct co-located BSSs can coexist. So if that is, we can have different networks in the same place. Okay, EDIROM, we could also have, you know, Telia, Wi-Fi, or whatever. Extended service set is identified by an SSID, which is this network name, for instance, EDIROM. And multiple of these BSSs are interconnected with this distribution system. We will see that in a second. That's essentially this LAN here. So a BSS is like a cell, and the stations in the BSS communicate with an access point. Porters are attached to the distribution systems to provide access to the internet. Communication, however, in Wi-Fi is also possible to do outside the context of a BSS, which is this what was used for traffic safety. We will not talk about this at all here. So we will concentrate on basic service sets and when we have an access point. But before doing that, let's talk about the thing where we don't have an access point. So here we have a number of stations here that would like to communicate with each other. However, none of them are is an access point, but they can still form a network. And this is called an ad hoc network. So we could create one here, a private Wi-Fi network, which is only for us, if we agree upon that. And then one of our laptops have to take the role as the coordinator somehow, or initiator of this network. And then one can attach to this network. And then when we move out to this lecture hall, this network disappears. Right? So an ad hoc network is something which is formed temporarily within a small area or a physical area. And then when communication needs are gone, this one is disbanded. Okay, so we won't talk so much about this. So let's go into the infrastructure Wi-Fi. And infrastructure means that we have a designated access point, okay, where all the communication goes through. So here we have two basic service sets, A and B, two access points, one and two, a number of stations. And then the access points here are attached to a distribution system. We can think of that as an Ethernet backbone or something like that. It could also be wireless. And together, the distribution systems and the basic service sets forms an extended service set. So if there is some data that goes from A1 to A2, it doesn't go directly radio. The frame is first sent to the AP, which processes the frame and then sends it to A2. A frame that goes from A1 to B1 first goes to the access point, then over the distribution system to this access point and down to this station. And if I want to go to the internet, I go from station to access point via the distribution system to the portal, which is the gateway to the internet. Questions? No? Okay. So this distribution system, it basically connects BSSs. So the distribution system then can transfer frames and it actually transmits MSDUs, which is MAC service data units. So we can think of that the protocol layer here, there is a MAC layer that receives an LLC frame. So LLC is on top of Wi-Fi. That LLC frame is the MAC service data unit. Okay, so that could be moved around between the APs here. So the MAC frames goes back and forth here. It can also transfer between portals and BSSs and also between stations. So an extended service sets look like a single service set for the LLC layer. For the LLC layer, it does not know anything about the distribution system and the access points and so forth. It only knows that it can communicate with a number of stations that are all attached to the extended service set. Okay. Infrastructure services. We can associate, reassociate, disassociate. Okay, so what does that mean? Well, if this is a laptop B, for instance, and we power that up, then it scans for available networks and then finds an access point. If this access point we have never attached to this one before, we need to log on to the network, and we do that by providing a password, usually. So this is association. Once we associated here, we're a bona fide member of the basic service set, and therefore also a bona fide member of the extended service set. So we can start to communicate. Okay. So association is basically that we log on to the network through an access point. Reassociation means that we are going from one basic service set to another basic service set. Okay. So we basically it's like a handover between two access points. So this enables mobility. Disassociation is basically that we log off, we leave the network. Authentication is when we start. We'll see a little bit later next week what that means, but it's basically to say that we can verify identities of the stations. And then there is something called a privacy here. And privacy in this case does not mean privacy in the sense of personal data being shared by others or viewed by others. So in Swedish, integritet. So this is not privacy. Privacy here means basically encryption. So it will be impossible to listen to the radio signals and figure out what the content of the data that is transmitted is. Okay, so it's encryption. We'll see more about that later on. And what we used was a WPA2, and this is what you should use nowadays. Okay, there is something called WEP or WEP, which is useless security. So you should not use that. Okay. Medium access then. Okay, so how do we send frames here? Okay, we know what to do on Ethernet. We use carrier sense, multiple access, we use collision detection, retransmissions, binary exponential backoff, and things like that. Can we reuse that for wireless? Yes and no, I would say. So one thing we cannot do in wireless, or at least which is not used in Wi-Fi, is collision detection. And the reason for that is that the transmitted signal has very much higher power than the received signal. So it's very hard to detect a collision while you are transmitting. We'll get back to that later on. But anyways, we can use a carrier sense with collision avoidance rather than collision detection. So I will try to explain what the differences are. Collision detection is very, very hard to use in wireless, and that has to do with the power difference between the transmit and receive signals. For instance, it's not uncommon at all that there is a 100 dB difference between the transmit power and the power we receive. Okay, and 100 dB is 10 to the power of 10, so it's there is a ratio between transmitted power and incoming power which is about 10 billion, right? 10 to the 10, it's a large number. Okay. So when we send some wireless signal, if we then open up the receiver, the chances is that we burn up the receiver. It goes up in smoke, essentially. Right. So that's not so good. So collision detection is very hard to use, even though there is research ongoing now trying to enable this, but it's still very much in its early stages. So there are no products that I know of. Carrier sensing also in wireless is not perfect. And the reason for that is that even though stations A and C, for instance, belong to the same network, they might not be in radio range of each other. So station A and station C needs to be in radio range of the access point, otherwise everything's pointless, right? But station A and station C might not be able to hear each other. Okay, so carrier sensing is not perfect in wireless. So one problem one can have in that case is something called the hidden terminal problem. So let's go through that. So we have two stations, A and C, and they want to communicate with B. And think of B here as being an access point. It doesn't necessarily have to be that, but suppose it's an access point. So A wants to transmit the frame and then starts to do that. It listens to the channel, it's free, and then transmits that. Now, station C also wants to send a frame, so it listens to the medium, but it doesn't hear A. Okay, so it will think that A is that everything is clear, even though that A is actually transmitting a signal here. So we say that from the perspective of station C, station A is hidden. We cannot here at station C listen to the radio channel to figure out what A is doing, whether A is transmitting or not transmitting. It's hidden to us. So here carrier sensing fails. So what is the problem with that? Well, the problem is, of course, that if station C then gets a frame that it wants to transmit, it listens to the channel, is free, and then can transmit. And then there will be a collision of the frames at the access point. So the access point can hear A and C, but A cannot hear C, and C cannot hear A. And therefore, we can find collisions, even though we use carrier sensing. Was that clear? Okay, so what to do? What to do about this? Well, either one has to live with this and let the higher layers figure out what to do. Or we do some type of retransmission schemes based on acknowledgements, which is actually what we will try to do later on. Or we can use some other type of initiation of this transfer of a frame. So let's try that first here. So CSMA with request to send and clear to send, or RTS-CTS. And this is a method for trying to limit the number of collisions we had due to hidden terminals. So what to do? When A has a frame to transmit, it doesn't send, and it sends the channel. If the channel is free, it doesn't send a frame, but rather a small, short frame called RTS, request to send to the access point. Okay. The access point says, okay, you're clear to send, and then send a clear to send, which is also a short frame to A. And C does not hear the RTS. That's the problem, right? It's A is hidden to C. So C doesn't hear anything from A. However, it needs to be connected to the access point. Otherwise, it would be pointless. So it can clearly hear the CTS, right? Because the CTS is sent from the access point. So here, B, so the access point here announces that A is clear to send. The CTS is then here by both A and C. Okay. And then A can send its frame, and C knows that something is going on because he heard the CTS here. So even though a frame might be waiting for transmission here, it knows it has to wait because it heard the CTS. It knows that A is transmitting. So was that clear? Questions? Okay. So what is better here is that the CTS and RTS here, the RTS and CTS are much, much shorter frames than the data frames. So for sure there could be collisions here because, you know, C could start to transmit something when RTSs could clearly collide with each other, just as data frames could be colliding here. If we replace data frames here with RTSs, we get the same problem. However, the RTS is much shorter, which means that we spend less of the time with collisions than if we collided data frames. So there is still a gain here. There is another problem that could occur also when it comes to carrier sensing. And this is quite a common problem in today's situation because we have many, many wireless networks. Okay, and they are competing for the same radio resources. So suppose we have two networks, one with access, or it could be the same actually, but we have an access point here and an access point here. We have two stations. Station number one transmits a frame, so it transmits that to access point number one. Some of that signal is spread in all directions, so some of that will be picked up by station number two, and some will be picked up by station access point number two here. So this here will block station number two, because station number two, if station two has a frame to transmit, it will hear that something is ongoing and will not transmit. Okay. Now, suppose that station number two actually transmitted. Okay, before that. So this part that goes from here to here is interference to access point number two, because it's not interested in this data. So any other frame that would come into the access point here would have to live with the interference which is caused here. Okay, which is could be okay, right? Now, suppose that station number two anyways transmitted. What's going to happen then? Well, it will be the reciprocal of the blue arrows here. We had the red arrows. So the frame will go here to the access point number two because that's where it's going. There will be some interference here, and there will be also some signal which is picked up by station number two. Okay. Is this a problem? It could be, or it could not be. And it depends really on the ratio between the power of the desired signal and the interference at the access point, which is here the ratio between the blue power and the dashed red one. Okay, that needs to be high enough for access point number one to be able to get decode the frame from station number one. And the same thing is in here. Access point number two is listening to the red frame here. It will be able to decode that if the power here is higher, sufficiently higher than the interference. Okay. So for clearly, right, when I send a frame now from my laptop, there are many other frames which are in the air everywhere in the world, and not all of them will cause harmless interference to my transmission. So the power ratio here is the important thing. So the signal to interference ratio, that is the power of the desired signal to the power divided with the power of the interfering power, if that is high enough, then access point number one would be able to decode the frame from access point from station number one. Right? Then, if that is the case, then there was no need to block station number two, because station number two did not cause harmful interference to station number one at access point number one. So there was no need to block it. Furthermore, if the signal to interference ratio here at access point number two, here, this is the desired signal and here is the interference. If that is high enough, then for sure the frame from station number two could be decoded here. So we see here, if these two conditions are true, and they could very well be there, we can actually use the same radio medium for both stations at the same time. So collisions are not necessarily bad. Okay, what determines a collision if it's bad or not is the signal to interference ratio at the receiver. Now, when we have many networks, then there is a lot of traffic ongoing, and it could be like stations are unnecessarily being blocked. Okay, so in this situation, for instance, and this is called the exposed terminal problem. So when station number two, for instance, in this case, suppose station number one initiated, it got the channel first, right? Then it blocks station number two, but it's unnecessary because station number two could very well transmit and everything would be okay anyways. Then we say that station number two is an exposed terminal. It is actually being blocked, but unnecessarily. Okay, and this is a problem, a clear problem in today's deployment where Wi-Fi networks are so common, right? They're everywhere. So there is a lot of work in the IEEE in order to figure out good ways to handle these situations so we can actually allow concurrent transmissions when these two conditions are fulfilled. On the other hand, we cannot allow concurrent transmissions when the signal to interference ratio is too small at the receivers, because then we have harmful collisions. So what we would like to do is to allow collisions that are not harmful while avoiding harmful conditions. It's a little bit tricky, right? So we won't go into the details on how this is done. But we want to do that. Okay. Little bit more about the details here then. So we have a MAC layer. It's responsible for channel access. It's also responsible for addressing, error checking, and retransmissions to some extent, and then also to possibly fragment and reassembly of Mac SDUs. And that's essentially what that means, is that a Wi-Fi card, say in this laptop, if it gets a 2,000 byte long message to transmit, it's free to do that in 100 byte chunks if he likes, as long as these are glued together at the receiving end. So we can use segmentation here. That's okay. The MAC layer is also responsible for security. We'll talk more about that next week. And it's also responsible for management. That is, how are we going to make sure that we can go from one access point to another without having to log on to the network again. And then it's also responsible for power management, because we know maybe you had an old cell phone where you had a Wi-Fi card that you never enabled because it ate up all your battery. I had that once. Now it's much, much better. And the reason for that is that we have power management. So whenever the Wi-Fi card is not needed to be powered up, it powers down. Okay, to save batteries. Saving batteries is crucial in wireless when we have mobile terminals. Okay, more into detail about MAC services. We do best effort, and that is mandatory, and that's what's used in practice. There is also a service where we do contention-free services. It's essentially what some type of scheduling MAC that we talked about earlier on. We will not talk about that, and the main reason for that is not used in practice. Okay, so it's not something that's used in practice, so let's forget about that. But anyways, we have MAC service data units that should be transmitted. So this is the upper layer, so it goes MAC service data units, goes up and down. We could have this contention-free service, but it's never used in practice, so let's forget about it. Then let's go for the contention service, and then we have this medium access method, which is known as distributed coordination function, DCF. What that means, it implements as a version of this carrier sense multiple access collision avoidance. So there is a lot of acronyms here, so I'm sorry for that, but that's just the way it is. So here we have the MAC layer that's responsible for the access, and it's quite on top of the physical layer here. Okay, so how is this done? Well, it's carrier sensing. So carrier sensing, what does it mean? It means that if a frame is available for transmission, one listens to the medium. If the medium is idle, we transmit. If it's not idle, we need to do something else. We need to back off somehow. So that's the main idea. The details here is as follows. When a station has a frame to transmit, it needs first to listen to the medium for an extended period of time, namely for one DIFS. And DIFS here stands for, we will see that on the next slide, what that means. But there is some time we need to wait. And if the medium is busy, then we need to wait until it's, then we need to wait. And what to do then is that we wait another time interval, and then we have a back off time, and then we can transmit the frame here. We'll go through a more detailed example shortly. Yeah. The idea is that ready stations, that is stations that have frames to transmit, has to wait for the completion of transmission. Right? So that's carrier sensing. And all stations must wait a certain interframe space before attempting to transmit. This will be clear in a second when we go through an example. Okay, so priorities are handed out through this interframe spacing. So suppose I'm a station and I want to send some data, and then I have to wait until the station the current transmission is over, and then I have to wait another time, which is this interframe space, before I can go into back off. So I can wait a SIFS, a PIFS, or a DIFS. Okay, these have different duration. So suppose I'm a station, I have to wait for a SIFS, then I have some back off time I need to wait until I can start to attempt to transmit my frame. The shorter this interframe space is, the shorter the time is from here to when I can start to transmit. So this is some type of priority. So if a station has a SIFS interframe spacing or a DIFS interframe spacing, the one which has the shorter interframe spacing typically wins in the contention for the channel. We'll see an example later on for this. So shorter interframe spacings gives priority to channel access. DCF, IFS, okay, a distributed coordinating function, interframe spacing, DIFS for short. We need to wait that before we can start to transmit the first frame. And then higher priority frames needs to wait only for a shorter interframe spacing. And this is typically for completing a transfer of data. We'll see that in a second. And also for acknowledgements and other things. Okay. I think... actually think we're going to go through an example here instead. Okay. And then go back and see what the details are. I think maybe this is the better way to do it. Okay, suppose we want to transmit now frames and we are not using CTS, RTS. Okay, so this is the basic, the simplest way we can do this. So we have a source and there is a destination and then there is a bunch of other nodes here. So we can think of the source as being, say, station number B. And then we have an access point, which is the destination. And then we have all other stations, which are in the vicinity here. So first, we have in the source, we have some frame to transmit. We have to wait the diffs. And the channel needs to be idle during the diffs. If it's not, then it's declared busy. Then we transmit the data frame. Okay. So here, everything was cool. We waited for diffs, the channel was free, and then we transmit the frame. What's going to happen then is that at the destination, at all other nodes, they will notice that the data frame is in progress. Right? It will hear the data frame, potentially after a short propagation delay, which is ignored here. And then it can read in the data frame, there is a field saying that this data frame will require X microseconds before it's completed. And then all other nodes will read that part in the data frame here and then defer their access until that time has passed. Okay? So all other nodes here, while here, so B starts to transmit its frame, then C and A listens to hears this frame and say, okay, so B is transmitting, and B tells us it's going to use 10 microseconds for doing that. Then I know for sure there's no need for me to try to access the channel until 10 microseconds has passed because it's busy. Right. Okay, so all the other nodes use this, and there is a field called nav to keep track of this network allocation vector. I'll talk more about that in a second. Okay, so the source here receives the data frame. Suppose everything is okay, so the access point checks for the CRC and say, okay, this is an error-free frame, and then wants to send an acknowledgement back. So the frame has gone here, it has been processed, and now the acknowledgement should go back. Okay. The acknowledgement goes back actually after exactly one SIFS. Okay. So after one SIFS, the destination, which is the access point here, transmits an ACK frame back. And now, here, the transaction of transmitting the data frame is complete. Okay. So in the duration field in the data frame, it takes into account the time it takes to get the ACK back. Questions? Okay, so now everything is back to normal again. This is one, the transmit of one frame. So now, after one diffs, we can start again. And suppose this source has another frame to transmit. So it transmitted its first frame, but then has a second frame to transmit. When can it do that? Then the rules is that you have to wait for a diffs and then do a back off. And the reason why you want to do a back-off here is because you might want to give station A and C a chance to also transmit their frames. Okay, so the back-off here, we do that by picking a random number and then wait for these random slots to pass, before we can start to transmit the next frame. And actually, if we didn't do that, then it could be a lot of collisions happening here, because all of the stations have been waiting now. Maybe they have frames to transmit. If they wait for just one diffs and then go and transmit, it will be collisions here for sure. So everyone needs to back off, not only the one that transmitted, but everyone. Okay. So, going back then to the description here, if the channel becomes busy before a diffs, then a station must schedule its back-off time for a reattempt at some later time. Okay, so if I have a frame, listen to the channel, and the channel is busy, then I have to back off. The waiting station then monitors the medium and decrements its back-off counters every time there is an idle time. Here. So, stations who are waiting are backing off their slots here, but they're only decrementing their back-off counter if the station, if the medium is idle. If it becomes busy from some other transmission, it halts its back-off counter. And station's transmission backoff counters expires. A station that has completed a frame transmission is not allowed to transmit immediately. And this is because we want to get other stations involved in this. So when station B has captured the channel, transmitted its frame, and received its acknowledgement back, it needs to wait until it transmits the next frame. Otherwise, maybe station A and station C never can get the opportunity to transmit. As a matter of fact, both B, A, and C are waiting their back-off times, and then one of them will win, have the shortest back-off time, and then capture the channel and do the transmission. Okay, there is an exception to this rule. Carrier sensing, it could be in two ways. Either it's physical carrier sensing, measuring power on the radio channel to hear that something is ongoing, or it could be virtual carrier sensing. So physical is when we analyze all the detected frames and monitor the relative strength from other sources. So basically, it listens to the channel. If the received power is higher than some threshold, we say that the channel is busy. That's physical carrier sensing. Virtual carrier sensing is to actually decode frames which are in transit. And then source stations inform other stations of how long it needs to transmit before it's done in microseconds. And this is carried in a special header, a field in the header. Then it says what the duration of the current transmission is. And it's in the data frames, but also in the RTS and CTS frames. And then station adjusts something that is called network allocation vector to indicate when the channel will become idle. And the channel is busy with either this one or this one says it's busy. So we use both at the same time. So going back here, this nav field here could be due to reading the duration of the duration field in the data frame, or by just hearing that something is ongoing here. All right. So this was a little bit hurried today, so I'm sorry for that. We'll just have to pick up the ball on Monday and then finish off Wi-Fi at that time. And then also talk a little bit about security on Monday. For the security part, there are two videos which are on ping pong that some other people have done, who's done nice lectures on this. So instead of reading the book, what you can do is to look at these videos. So please do that to be prepared for the lecture on Monday. Then things will be much easier. Okay. So see you on Monday.